All right, everyone, thanks for joining once again and welcome in this Managing Risk with Copilot in Microsoft 365. We'll talk about what kind of options we have here related to Copilot in Microsoft 365, where we deal with data security. So first of all, I would like to introduce myself. My name is Saurabh Srivastav, and currently I'm working in Koenig Solutions as technical lead. I have around more than 16 plus years of experience in production and corporate trainings. And I serve different roles in my past experience, like subject matter expert, architect, and different other roles I served in different organizations. My experience is mainly moving around Azure Cloud, Microsoft 365, Office 365, you can say. I have good experience in security, privacy, compliance components. In very early days when it was Exchange 2003 and OCS 2003, at that time I started this IT journey with messaging, communication, collaboration products. So I have mainly Microsoft products in my profile, and I am CT, Microsoft Certified Trainer, since past 11 years. So this is my brief introduction. Now we're going to see what we are going to cover today. We are going to cover some introduction related to Copilot, what we have in Copilot in Microsoft 365. We'll talk about explore data security with Copilot for Microsoft 365. And we have topic to see apply appropriate data security controls. So this is our today's agenda that we are going to cover. Let's start with this, what we have in this webinar. You know, in Copilot for Microsoft 365, this is not a kind of new name. Everybody is now talking about Copilot, and we have Copilot available in Microsoft 365 applications. We are bringing Copilot in security and in Azure components. So we are extending our hands to different places. But Copilot is designed with basically, you can say three main components. Copilot itself, the first one. Second, large language model, that is the brain of this Copilot. And Microsoft Graph, that is going to govern your data, your organization and tenant data. So these three things work together, and these are going to give you capability of using your own natural language and asking different kind of questions. You can send prompt to Copilot and you get results. You can utilize Copilot in Microsoft 365 applications to the web. You can use Copilot in your Windows 11 devices as well. So we are extending this Copilot usability to different places. Definitely Copilot is going to enhance your day-to-day working experience, enhancing your productivity, and saving lots of time in your day-to-day activities, especially for what kind of traditional or maybe if you have a traditional way of working, that you can automate, that you can change using Copilot. For example, you have a kind of Word document, any project document, and you want to write an email related to that project details. If you're going in traditional way, you have to read the entire document and then you can draft any email related to these data. This may take some time, maybe 10 to 15 minutes, 20 minutes, depending on the need. If you're going to send this email to your customer, to your stakeholders, you'll be very careful. Copilot can do this thing within a minute. And this will be changing if you want to change your way of communication, or you want to change a draft, you want to change draft in different language, different kind of tone, Copilot can do this within minute. So you can save lots of time in your day-to-day work if you are going to utilize Copilot for your traditional kind of work activities. So here, what we have, Copilot users are more productive. If you are using Copilot, what Copilot user says, they said, spending less time processing email, 64%. 71% save time on maybe you can say day-to-day activities or mundane tasks. 75% save time on finding whatever they need in their files. You can simply send instructions to Copilot and asking, I'm looking for this kind of data. Check my files in my OneDrive. Instead of going to check each and every file, Copilot can bring this in front of you within seconds. 85% get to a good first draft faster. So these kind of experience our Copilot users are going to see, and they are enhancing their experience using this one. So more understanding. So Copilot for Microsoft 365 is designed on different kind of principles. First of all, we have security foundation. Copilot is designed on top of what kind of security, compliance, and different kind of privacy components we have in our organization. Copilot is going to respect all these. It not means, like, for example, if any user is denied for any data, in general, if that user is going to open SharePoint or OneDrive place, or maybe he is restricted for some kind of data and document. So using Copilot, that user cannot access it. Copilot is not going to bypass your security or privacy or compliance components. This will always respect whatever you have already created in your organization. Definitely Copilot, AI at work, this is going to be your personal AI assistant. You can use it in your day-to-day activity, in your day-to-day basis. You can find ways how you can utilize Copilot efficiently in your different way of work in different types of departments, because Copilot is designed for keeping in mind that Copilot can be used in HR, in marketing, in sales, in IT, everywhere. Definitely, if you are going to use Copilot, you will see a kind of cultural shift. Instead of doing all the activities in a kind of traditional way, you are going to perform activities in kind of based on AI assistant. AI assistant will help you in lots of automations, lots of activities where you can save time for other important work. So when we talk about Copilot in Copilot Microsoft 365 component, this is going to work in different departments. This is going to work with different type of people. I can utilize Copilot in marketing, in sales activities, in customer service, in finance, operations, data and IT professionals, and also in HR as well. Everywhere, we have to find ways how we can utilize Copilot for my day-to-day activities. For example, if I talk about HR, any HR can utilize Copilot to draft any kind of initial job requirement that he or she wants to post over the internet or over the job websites. HR can utilize or email to send any kind of offer email to any kind of person who has been hired. Maybe you can create induction documentations using Copilot in Word. So lots of things we can do in our day-to-day activities that generally we perform these activities in traditional way. Even for finance, these guys can analyze Excel sheets, lots of numbers. Using Copilot, they can analyze this within seconds. They can generate formula to calculate maybe Excel sheets. So if they are going to use Copilot in Excel, they can, you know, create different kind of visualizations, different kind of outcomes they can find from any kind of sheet. So you have to find how you can use Copilot. So possibilities are limitless. You can ask your question, you can ask a prompt, and Copilot will respond on your prompt based on its own understanding and what different kind of possibilities we have. For example, if you talk about customer service, I am directly attached to customer related queries and customer services. I can utilize Copilot to maybe drafting emails that I want to send to my customers. Maybe I can ask to Copilot, Copilot can tell you what different kind of meeting has been organized, where you were the participant, what was the meeting outcome, what kind of questions has not been resolved yet. So these all things you can ask to Copilot. You need to check what different kind of options we have where we can utilize these. So definitely, if you are going to start with Copilot, Copilot will definitely bring AI value in your organization. In different type of, you can say in across line of businesses, different types of departments can utilize this for different kind of work activities, seeing how we can enhance our productivity using Copilot. So all roles, anybody can use Copilot: HR, marketing, operations, IT, sales, finance, customer services, people, they can utilize this. So you can see some examples here. Example, if you talk about HR, they can calculate our draft cost per hire, employee turnover, compliance risk reductions. These are different things, these kind of different activities you can perform with the help of Copilot. In IT, looking for outstanding support tickets, application downtime, departmental spendings, lots of things you can utilize, you can calculate, or you can generate documentations and data using Copilot. Definitely for this, we have Copilot scenario library here. And this scenario library is going to help you to learn more on this, what different kind of scenarios we have, like HR scenario, IT scenario, sales, finance. You can go to scenario library. It's very simple. You can search for Copilot for Microsoft 365. You will get the main page, and there you will have this scenario library listed. So if you're interested, if you, for example, you are from finance or you're from IT or from HR, you can explore your library or your section to see how Copilot is going to help you in different kind of activities. But definitely, if you are willing to use Copilot, we have some kind of licensing requirements. In this licensing requirement, Copilot for Microsoft 365 is available $30 per user per month. But you cannot go for 1 month trial. You have to go for a complete 1 year billing. So you have to pay for $360 for a single user, and you have to go for entire year billing. So this is for Copilot for Microsoft 365. We have different Copilot versions as well. There are some Copilot versions which are free. We can use them free of cost. But when we are talking about specifically Copilot for Microsoft 365, this will be available in this kind of licensing model. So once again, $30 per user per month is a general cost, but you cannot go for 1 month. You have to go for the entire year billing, entire year payment. So you have to pay $360 per user. If you have maybe 10 users, maybe you have to pay for $3,600 in one single go if you want to purchase their licenses. So this is available right now for every organization, but interesting thing is, if I talk about last year, when it was introduced for so many months, it was only available to different kind of premium customers or some selected customers based on invitations or invite from Microsoft. But right now, anybody can purchase it and they can start using. So when we talk about different Copilot, we have different type of Copilot options available in Microsoft. Here we have Copilot available for individuals. and for organizations. So generally, whatever the free version of Copilot we say, that gives you Copilot available over the web in Bing and also over Microsoft Edge browsers, you get Copilot completely free. Where you get these kind of capabilities, foundational capabilities, you have web grounding, going to search over the web, and commercial data protection options we have in Copilot. But when we talk about more, example, if you talk about Copilot in Outlook, Word, Excel, PowerPoint, OneNote, a priority model access, advanced capability in Copilot, these all will be available only in, if you talk about individual, we have Copilot Pro. And this is available in $20 per month per user pricing, and you have to again go for the annual billing here. If you want to modify or you want to change, you want to go for in development for individuals, we have Copilot GPT Builder that you can download and you can install in your devices and start working with if you want to develop something for customizations. For organization, once again, we have Copilot for free available over the web and Edge browser and Bing chat as well. But if you talk about, you want to use all feature set, for all feature set, you have to go for $30 per user per month for annual billing, and you'll get all these features listed in this Copilot for Microsoft 365, especially Copilot in Teams. This is listed here, and you can use this under Copilot for Microsoft 365. If you are interested in development, you want to develop your own Copilot components, or maybe you want to develop, maybe you want to train Copilot related to your organization data, you can go for Copilot Studio. This is for development, and you can select extending Copilot capabilities to different levels. This is something that you have to keep in mind, that we have different kind of options in Copilot. Now, if you talk about some more options, for example, if you talk about Copilot specifically, what is available for different kind of roles or services, especially for sales, you can see we have to pay for $50 per user per month. And Copilot for services, for service and different kind of like IT services and other different kind of things. If you want to utilize other components like, you know, role specific capabilities comes under this extra billing, like you have to pay $20 more in comparison to Copilot for Microsoft 365. And you have to pay $50 per user per month in a kind of annual billing. So these are different kind of Copilot versions are available. Here we are talking about this Copilot for Microsoft 365 that you have to go for in $360 per user per year billing option. Now, here I would like to tell you what kind of basic working functionality we have in Copilot, how Copilot works when you are going to send any form. This will be helpful to understand the backend design of Copilot, and then we'll move to what kind of data security components we have in Copilot. Now, this represents what different kind of components are involved in any kind of Copilot processes. So when you talk about architecture, there are three main components. Copilot itself, that is going to orchestrate or automate all your prompts. The second, that is Microsoft Graph. This graph is basically related to your tenant, Microsoft tenant, or your organization tenant, where you have all the data related to emails, files, meeting chats, calendar, contacts, everything is in the control of Microsoft Graph. And we have large language model, LLM, that is something going to understand what kind of prompt users are sending in natural language format. This is the third important component in this. So just to understand this, what happens User sends prompt using Copilot option in applications, and this prompt comes to Copilot here. Like example, you say, draft an email to my customer informing that we have launched a new product. So this natural language prompt comes to Copilot. The Copilot will send this prompt to Microsoft Graph. Microsoft Graph will get this prompt, and basically before sending this one, they perform some kind of grounding. Grounding means understanding the prompt, what this prompt says. So Microsoft Graph will get this, but Microsoft Graph will not be able to understand because Microsoft Graph is related to only the data, providing the data information. So Microsoft Graph will connect to large language model. Now this is large language model. This large language model is the brain of Microsoft Copilot. So here, this will be understanding what kind of natural language you have. And this language will be again post, you can say this will be processing it. And thereafter, sending the understand the prompt what we have completed or what we are going to understand here. This will be a kind of LLM response going back to the Microsoft Graph. Now Graph will understand what actually user is looking for. And then this will be collecting your data from all these places and providing this data back to the user. But here is a very important thing that you have to keep in mind. Before sending the data, this will be applying compliance and security settings before providing this data to the user. User will not be able to see any data for which the user is not allowed. So very simple processes. You get the response here. Yes, Copilot will get the prompt. Copilot will process this prompt and sends this to Microsoft Graph. Microsoft Graph will connect to LLM to understand what is the user intent. The user intent will be, you can say, processed by large language model. This will understand what user is looking for. This will inform to Microsoft Graph that user is looking for email or data or chats. And Microsoft Graph will send that data, but before sending this data to the user via this Copilot, this will perform security, compliance, and privacy check. And user will get data that is a secure data or maybe for which the user is allowed. In this process, Microsoft Graph and Copilot, they also contact to external sources, maybe to Bing or maybe to any other plugin that you have in your organization to bring data or information from that place. Also, Microsoft Graph not only check what data we have in my on-prem, means in my organization, in my Microsoft 365 end, but this can also get data from power connectors as well. Suppose you have power application connectors, power platform connectors, so you can connect data from that place. Microsoft Graph can get this information, and based on the prompt, this can provide information to the user. So here, we have three main components. The Copilot orchestration layer, Microsoft Graph, that is your own data, and third one is LLM that understand your natural language prompt and provide information about the user intent, what user is actually looking for, what data user is looking for. And this works continuously to provide you lots of responses. But here, one thing we should not forget, Copilot is a kind of AI, and this is learning. This is going to understand different kind of intent. It may be possible what you are asking, Copilot is not able to understand. So you have to change, maybe you have to change your prompt, the language, maybe asking the question in a different way. That's why we see different kind of need of prompt designing. And for that, you have lots of job roles are popular. Now these are in the market like prompt engineers. They design prompt or they create prompt that Copilot or other AI systems can understand. But definitely over time, when Copilot will be extending its own knowledge, its own processing in the backend, the more advanced Copilot we get in future, this will be understanding most of the prompt what we are going to send to Copilot. Here you can see the capability of Copilot is, if you are going to send your prompt in a broken language, not properly following the grammar, or if your keywords, spells are not correct, even in this case, Copilot can understand what actually you are looking for. So this kind of architecture we have in Copilot that we see. But in all these, the most important thing is compliance, privacy, security components. And this is a very, very important point where Copilot is going to pay attention always before providing the data to the uniform. No policy, no security settings, no compliance setting will be ever bypassed. So you can say your data is always secure with Copilot. And even what data you have here, the data Microsoft Graph is providing to your user based on your form, this data is never exposed to this LLM model. It means Copilot is not going to use your organization data for its own learning or for training purposes. Data will be always with Microsoft Graph. And this will be provided to the user prompts. LLM or even Copilot itself is not going to use your company's secret as any kind of confidential data or any kind of important data for its own learning. So here we have this kind of capability in this. So most important thing comes here in Microsoft 365 that what kind of security components we have, how Copilot is going to respect your organization security. So for this, let's understand what we have. Copilot will provide or will work with Microsoft security component when you have proper license and also you have implemented your security compliance or privacy settings. So here we see three levels of security that is working with Copilot. Baseline, core, and best in class. In baseline, any organization they can go ahead with including Copilot Microsoft 365. So here, what are the recommendations? What kind of security components you see here? You can achieve multi-factor authentication, audit logging, where you can see what kind of, especially in audit logging, you can find information related to Copilot activities. But when you go for the core, that should be requirement for most of the organization. Here we can go with Copilot Microsoft 365 license, Microsoft 365 E3, and SharePoint Advanced Management. These kind of things you have to consider. So I can implement conditional access, security labels. I can go for manual options. We can go for DLP. We can implement advanced SharePoint site-wide access control and reporting, unified endpoint management. These all things comes under, because we are in Microsoft 365 license, this will give you these advanced security components. And if you are looking into best-in-class Copilot in Microsoft security components, you should go for E5 license here. That gives you conditional access based on identity risk, including intra-ID identity protection, you will have automatically apply sensitivity label. Here you're applying sensitivity label manually. Here you can apply automatic. You can automatically remove inactive content. You can prevent data leaks on endpoint devices, detect non-compliant usage. These all things comes under E5 license, Microsoft 365 E5. Along with this, if you're going to use Copilot, because I'm going to implement all these advanced security, Copilot will respect all these implementations. So to understand this, if we are going to use Copilot and we are going to use these different kind of licensing, how we should proceed, how we should go for deploying these services in a proper planning. So what we see in this, you see here, when you talk about apply appropriate data security controls, any organization will start with this first stage. They will first try to assess if their organization is ready for Microsoft 365 or Copilot for Microsoft 365 or not. Definitely is a kind of online assessment. Here we have 26 questions around. This will ask, this will present each and every question one by one. You need to answer. And you will see what is your current status. While answering, be very fair and providing the right information will help you to provide your right assessment. So generally we follow this kind of guidelines. It's like, are you ready to deploy advanced, maybe going for implementing data security controls? Because the thing is, if you have data security control already implemented in your Microsoft 365 environment, Copilot will use these security controls before providing any data to the user based on his prompt. So what Microsoft recommend, check if you are ready to deploy. If you are ready to deploy, like if you have implemented all your basically main security components. So yes, if you are here as yes, you can go for deploy Microsoft Copilot things, Copilot component. And on top of it, you can go for optimizing other security controls that comes under in core and also in best in class service that is related to the licenses. Like we can restrict here oversharing, data leak, or manual labeling policies. Here we can go for auto labeling, data leaks, prevent data oversharing. So we can implement this, and definitely, after implementing all these, if there is anything related to, like example, if you have enabled restricted SharePoint search setting. Because, see, if you don't have security in your organization, so at least for data oversharing, that would be possible. And any user using Copilot prompt, they can access any data that you are not planning to provide them. So if you are in this path that you are planning to implement security, in that case, what you can do? If you are saying yes, it means you have some basic level of security already implemented. If you're not ready to deploy, so do one thing, enable your restricted SharePoint search. And then after, this will give you some time where you can work on these different kind of settings. So most of the organization, what they do, they follow this path. They enable restricted SharePoint search. They will get enough time to deploy their Copilot related component security settings. And finally, they disable this restricted search once your security settings is implemented properly in organization. So security setting that includes lots of things. If these all are implemented well, then you can go for disabling restricted search if you have enabled it. So for most of the organization, because they are going to adopt Copilot now these days, they would be definitely using some good control in security and compliance and privacy. So whatever they have already implemented, that would be easily used by Copilot. And in this way, definitely you will have control on your data. You can keep using what existing policies you have. So you don't need to worry about, like, if Copilot can expose data that is not, maybe that is not allowed for a user, no, Copilot will never do this. But if any company who is starting from scratch, so they can follow in this way. Enable restricted SharePoint search, then keep these all things configured, or maybe we can go for deploying all these things, taking time like maybe 1 month, 2 weeks, or depending on how critical or how complex the environment is. And then after, we can go to this stage. So this is something that what we have here. So Microsoft gives you some guidelines that if you want to enhance security and compliance in your Copilot journey, definitely classify your data, understand what data you have, like what kind of general data you have, what kind of sensitive information you have, confidential. Then label your data using sensitivity labels and use DLP policy to prevent any kind of sensitive information oversharing or sharing to the wrong people or wrong person. So these are three main components that we see in this kind of security and compliance configurations. So information protection is most important thing that gives you, you can say, data classifications and also the data labeling option. So here we first classify the data based on different kind of sensitive information types in Microsoft 365. So if you have idea about Microsoft 365 Defender portal, then we have data classification tab where we can define what different kind of matching parameters we can configure for my data. Maybe in my company, a keyword project X is a kind of very important keyword for me, but the same keyword is not very important for other organization. So we can go for existing sensitive info types, what Microsoft has already created there in Defender portal, that we have around 316 type of data related to passport number, address details, driving license number. These all things we have already there from Microsoft side. But if I want to add my own sensitive info types or sensitive informations, I can add my custom data as well. Once my data is added there, I can use information protection labeling components. I can start creating labels to my different type of data where I will be using matching patterns. Matching patterns in the sense like I want to configure a rule that wherever Project X keyword comes in, please mark that document as confidential and limit other user access here. Like user can only view that document, but they cannot perform any printing, sharing, or maybe any kind of download options. These all things I want to disable. So label can not only mark your document with some kind of category, but also encrypt your document or data for some kind of reduced controls, or maybe we can create controlled environment. And definitely, if you want to keep your data for some time, you want to keep data for some, maybe based on some kind of compliance, I want to keep data for 10 years or 15 years or 5 years, we should not forget about compliance component, that is retention. We should implement that retention options as well, including DLP, in case if you are worried about that if data is going to be shared to outside of your organization or maybe inside, you can use DLP policy to control these kind of experiments. So here, this is just kind of example. It's a kind of Microsoft Purview portal compliance where we have this kind of data classification things what we see. So these classifications, we can come to by default instance to info types. We get lots of entries from Microsoft itself, around 316 different types of sensitive info types we see here. But yes, if I want to add my own, I can go for create sensitive info type related to my organization. And this I can use to create labels that can protect my data. So we can go for classifications. We can add my own information in organization in this kind of compliance portal. And then I can create labels, policies that I can apply to my documents. Here we have two options. These labels, these policies, can these different kind of settings can be applied to my documents automatically and manually as well. For automatically, we have to follow the sensitive information type matching patterns. So wherever matching patterns will come, will be appearing inside any document, any data, in PPT, Excel, Word file, label will be automatically applied. So when you apply labels, what happens? So for example, there's a kind of label that is an example is created, Project Obsidian. And this is going to, you can see lots of information here we have. The scope is any type of data. This will encrypt your document. This will be applied automatically. It's some kind of keyword like maybe Project Obsidian. And this is available here in this. So you can start creating your documents and data and you can apply label there. Or if you want to go for auto apply, this will check the keywords and label will be automatically implemented and protecting the document. So what happens if maybe any user, like example here we have documents we have documents I can apply label manually or automatically as well. So this is kind of Project Obsidian 0.5, and these all data we have here in this. So these kind of things, these kind of data where we have some keywords matching, they will be affected with this label. And what happens if you open any document, you see that label is already available here. So you will have limited rights here if you are a user and you are trying to access this document, because I can limit your access that you can only view, but you cannot modify the document. This is a general user experience. But what if you're going through Copilot? If you go to Copilot and asking, referring Project Obsidian in your prompt, what happens, you will get limited information here. If you're not allowed to even view the document, prompt will give you information that you're not allowed to get this file detail. Even, so you can see, this gives you information here that this is confidential. This will give you information about the label, what label is applied to the document. Even if you're going to use Copilot in Word and trying to refer this document, notice here, currently the label is general, means this is open for everyone. As soon as I, as a user, I'm going to refer this where I'm allowed to view this document. If anything is being created here, you can see the label will be changed to this. It means if you're going to refer any secure document in your organization in Copilot, so the label or restrictions will be inherited to your new document as well, automatically. So these kind of things, Copilot takes care of these stuff automatically. Also, for example, as an example, you're going to drop your Copilot and selecting this project. Again, you're creating this kind of information, like you're creating FAQs on Project Obsidian, and you see the label is automatically inherited. So this is a very good thing. You don't need to worry about that you have implemented a label and encryption on document. If Copilot will respect that thing or not, definitely yes, this will respect it. And this will inherit anything that is going to be created using that kind of secure document. So these things we see, we can also enable a retention policy. If I want to keep my data related to my Copilot interactions, Teams chats, so I can create a retention policy where I can keep my data safe for many, many years. Like here in this setting, they have requirement that keep content and delete it if it's older than 5 years. So they want to keep data for at least 5 years related to Copilot interactions as well. So maybe your company wants to keep information about what users are interacting in Copilot, what kind of prompt they're sending. So these things you can keep here in Copilot, in this retention policies, in data lifecycle management. So these are all things you should have in advance. For example, you are going to enable this policy after 5 years. So definitely, this will not be keeping the older five-year data if you're going to create policy today. Or maybe if you're going to plan it very well, we have some possibilities where you can keep, where you have data, maybe five-year-old or two-year-old or one-year-old data you can also get. But planning for security, compliance, and privacy should be in advance before going for introducing Copilot in your organization. The more understanding you can see when you go for creating retention policy, especially we have to look into this point. Teams chat and Microsoft 365 Copilot interaction, I want to keep in my policy. So if you are, maybe if you have experience with Microsoft Purview, so you'll get these kind of informations here listed in Purview, and you can create these kind of policies. Now, apart from this, if you go for Copilot, you have some kind of security, some kind of configurations and admin options here that comes under Admin Center, and you see this Copilot tab. This gives you different kind of settings, including data security and compliance options here. Especially for this, if you go, you can see under this, you can configure different settings. This gives you recommendations that if you want to start with Copilot, and if you want to keep your data safe, you want to maintain, manage risk, you should go for using sensitivity label, retention policy, enabling communication compliance, where Copilot will look into the interactions for any kind of unexpected keywords on it, or maybe any kind of, maybe any violations related to communication conducts. These all things Copilot can detect. Auditing and e-discovery, we should be using if we want to look into what different kind of Copilot interactions we have, any keyword search I want to go for, these options will be helpful. You can see there are some kind of learning links as well that you can click on, and you can learn about how sensitivity label, retention policy, communication compliance, audit, and discovery is going to work with Copilot. Now, also, if you talk about some kind of settings we have, especially in settings tab here, when you go to integrated apps, and when you go for this kind of, you know, Copilot components. So here you can see, it says the very important thing, who can use Copilot plugins in applications, like in Office applications or in other kind of, you know, Outlook, Teams, Microsoft apps. You can see by default is all user, but maybe in your company you want to enable this only for some users. So you can go for specific user groups, or you can select no user if you're not interested to enable Copilot plugin to different kind of applications. Maybe you are in the pilot phase and you are in the, you know, you can say rolling out design. So maybe you can go for no user first, and in a change window, you can enable this for all users. Now, apart from this, if you're interested, Microsoft recommend, if you allow, Copilot can check to the web interface or maybe the public web for any kind of recommendations. So this comes here in public web content under Copilot. You can enable this checkbox if you want to allow Copilot to reference public web content. Generally, Copilot is going to refer your own internal organization documents and data. But if you want to refer public web content as well for your interactions, you should enable this. So if you remember when I was talking about an architecture of Copilot, how this works, there was a kind of interaction that Copilot can connect with Bing and other web contents. This is the setting that you can keep enabled if you want to get references from public. Else, keep it off if you're very much concerned about security. Apart from this, Copilot generates lots of information, data related to how Copilot is being used in your organization. that comes under, let me show you. Basically, this comes under in your uses report here. And in uses report, you will get this Copilot for Microsoft 365 on the very top, where you can see all the Copilot informations, that how many licenses you have, how many users are already using it. You can easily see this kind of informations, and accordingly, you can plan. We can maybe sending email notifications to the user that we have assigned licenses to you to start using it. But these reports, who can see? These reports in this Copilot dashboard can be accessed by global admin account, Exchange admin, SharePoint admin, report reader, Teams admin, user experience success manager. These are different kind of roles that we have. They can check these reports, and accordingly, they can take decisions that what kind of Copilot users we have in our organization. You can see we have enabled, like in this kind of design, 45,608 user, but currently 30,805 active users are using it. So they're using Word, Excel, PowerPoint, Copilot everywhere in this. But still, the uses are very low. So accordingly, we can plan how we can, you know, maybe organizing trainings or organizing events for my users, employees, where I can maybe increasing them that how Copilot is going to save their time, how you can utilize Copilot for your day-to-day work activities. So these are different things that what we see, and especially for security and maintaining your data, avoiding any kind of risk, you should be very clear that we have security compliance. These components are already in place, especially data classification, information protection labeling. You can also consider retention policies. You can go for DLP policies as well. These all things, if you're going to implement, definitely Copilot will be providing information to your users and based on their form very precisely and without any kind of, you can say, bypassing the security settings, bypassing the privacy settings. That is something that is going to be totally avoided. So this was all related to this webinar, and this was just a kind of understanding related to how Copilot is going to utilize security and compliance components, how you can enhance security related to your data. And definitely we have lots of resources available over the internet, over Microsoft Learn pages. You can explore that pages to learn about how Copilot is going to closely work together with security and compliance settings. So meanwhile, if you have any question or query, we have still 5 minutes. So I'll be checking the chat window and answering your questions. If you have any question, feel free to ask. Okay, so seeing one question here, what is the difference between Microsoft Copilot AI and ChatGPT, OpenAI in terms of data security and prompts? So basically, when we talk about ChatGPT, LLM, the large language model, what we're talking about, the LLM is your, basically we know that LLM is your ChatGPT. Copilot is working along with LLM, that is ChatGPT, and this is going to provide all kind of understanding related to natural language prompts. And we have next one, what legal protections are in place for developers or organization that is Copilot, particularly in terms of liability for generated code that may cause security vulnerabilities or legal issues? So for this, I would say, first of all, when we talk about this kind of security components for developers, anything what you're going to develop in your Copilot Studio or maybe using a Copilot builder, for individuals, we can utilize, if you're going to, you know, publish this code to any places, like in Microsoft Teams extension places, or you are going to add this, maybe you're developing anything like, for example, graph connectors to connect data. So these all things, this different kind of integrity check, security check you can perform in these kind of development platforms. But when we talk about Copilot itself is designed based on a kind of responsible AI matrix, where this is going to follow different principles like fairness, security in Copilot, and many other different kind of components we have included. So definitely security is in place, especially for developers and designers as well. But maybe if you're talking about what about there's a kind of malicious code or vulnerabilities in that, so maybe for that you have to follow the software development lifecycle and different kind of tools we have to check the integrity and security components or vulnerability in the code. Copilot itself, if you're going to present your code maybe in a different way to Copilot to check the vulnerabilities in this or misconfigurations, Copilot can check. But during the development, maybe you have to go for third party or maybe whatever the tools available we have for checking the vulnerabilities and malicious configurations. So that would be following the software development lifecycle. The next one, can one tenant license of Copilot can be used in another tenant? As far as I know, one license that is connected to one tenant that is going to be, you can say tightly bound to any kind of tenant ID. So you'll not be able to use that in another tenant. So guys, thank you so much once again.